Well, good afternoon. My name is Ron Robinson. I'm president of Young America's Foundation, and on behalf of our team here, I want to welcome all of you here today. Really, in a lot of ways, when I think about the people that are here today, it represents the fuller picture of Young America's Foundation. Quite appropriately, we have students that are here learning to be better campus organizers in the first three or four rows. Standing behind them are many of our supporters who make their work possible, who support them and give them the wherewithal to bring the speakers, to conduct the activities on your respective college campuses. We also have some key alumni in the room. It's very risky to start dipping in looking at some of the long-term colleagues. But I see Mike Thompson, longtime vice president, vice chairman of Young Americans for Freedom, George McDonald, Don Lambro, some of the key YAF figures from the earliest days. George McDonald was on the first YAF board of directors. I see Stephen Morrison from Scotland. Stephen worked at the YAF office in the early 1980s, coordinating. He was a leader of the European Democratic Students and came to help coordinate the putting of the Cruz and Pershing missiles into Europe to help defend Western Europe against the Soviet Empire, as well as opposing the nuclear freeze, which threatened our nuclear deterrence. But Stephen has done key work, and so many others that have been an important part of Young America's Foundation. I would also be remiss if I didn't point out that Ronald Reagan is in the room in a way. As you know, we saved President Reagan's ranch, and that's probably what most of today's students know about Young America's Foundation as it relates to Ronald Reagan, but he joined the YAF Advisory Board in 1962 and was active until his final speech in 1993, hosting us all 8 years at the White House when he was president. And there are many, many ways in which Reagan touched the lives of people in our organization and continues to do so at the Reagan Ranch. But after you've heard today's speaker and enjoyed today's lunch, I would urge you to take a peek at some of the items from the Reagan collection in these two cases in the back of the room. It includes a couple of the Reagan Bibles. It includes Ronald Reagan's copy, an 1801 copy of Wealth of Nations, a three-volume set of Wealth of Nations that was President Reagan's, as well as some of the Reagan family's favorite pictures of Ronald Reagan, both as a young man and then later as governor or president of the United States. And of course, the foundation team, the staff members that I'm working with currently, many of them just standing over there looking like they're ready to ditch the room if given a chance to hit the meal line or something. Some looking at their watches and wondering how long I'm going to talk. They, of course, day to day make the work at Young America's Foundation with the students possible, and I appreciate them being with us. In fact, they all were very important campus activists in their days. In just a moment, I'll introduce Jessica Jensen, who will introduce our primary speaker, but she's also a good example of that. But I would be remiss not to say that the board is also present. Around here, people are used to me giving a lot of direction to the organization, but I take direction from the board of directors of Young America's Foundation, and Peter Schweizer is my boss. So it's always great to have him back with us, but he was a campus activist. He may share some of that. He was a board member of Young Americans for Freedom and has served in many capacities. I'll leave it to Jessica to enumerate those, but it's great to have a board representation here as well today. So on to the program. Jessica Jensen is the Chief of Staff of Young America's Foundation. If you enjoy these facilities here, she basically designed the layout of this headquarters that we moved into 2 years ago after being in our headquarters on Eldon Street for 25 years, place that Peter and Stephen both worked for a while, or at least they were employed there for a while. Jessica is also the editor of Libertas, our primary publication. She was a leader that came out of St. Scholastica in Minnesota. And for the purposes of introduction, I call upon Jessica Jensen.
Ron. Good morning. It is an honor to introduce our guest speaker today. Young America's Foundation alumnus Peter Schweizer has spent his career exposing and defending the principles that exposing corruption and defending the principles that make America great. Along the way, he has also become a regular name on the New York Times bestseller list, and in 2015, he released his explosive book, Clinton Cash, the untold story of how and why foreign governments and businesses helped make Bill and Hillary rich. This blockbuster spent much of 2015 on the New York Times bestseller list, climbing to the number two position. Indeed, the success was merited, as Peter's work in researching and writing Clinton Cash undoubtedly led to the unraveling of Hillary Clinton at the beginning of her presidential bid, and the facts unveiled in this book continued to plague her efforts throughout her campaign. As a Huffington Post writer noted, Clinton Cash is the single most damaging attack on Hillary. And a simple search of the term Clinton Cash in John Podesta's WikiLeaks emails shows just how nervous the Clinton camp was before and after the release of this explosive expose. However, as Peter continues to make waves, he has never lost sight of his roots nor forgotten the flame ignited at a Young America's Foundation conference more than 30 years ago. Peter began his long journey with the foundation as a high school student at our 1982 National Conservative Student Conference. Recognizing his many talents, the foundation offered him a scholarship to attend the George Washington University and later Oxford University. He joined the foundation staff in 1993, serving as a research fellow and director of academic affairs, and as Ron noted, as editor of our magazine, Libertas. It was not long before Schweitzer's prolific writing career took off. Over the last two decades, he has authored four New York Times bestsellers, two of which were featured on CBS's 60 Minutes. Peter is the founder and president of the Government Accountability Institute and has served as a fellow at the Hoover Institution. He's been a consultant to the Office of Presidential Speechwriting and since 2007, a director of Young America's Foundation. Since releasing Clinton Cash, which has already been turned into a documentary film and a best-selling graphic novel, Peter has appeared on nearly every major news network in the Washington Post, New York Times, Wall Street Journal, and dozens of other media outlets have also featured stories on his work. Of his attendance at his first foundation conference, Peter said it was there where he discovered that books can really influence people and over the long term, and that's why I turned to writing books after college. If Clinton Cash is one example of the influence Peter's books can have, we at Young America's Foundation certainly hope he keeps writing. Please join me in welcoming Peter Schweizer.
Thank you very much. It feels like I'm coming to a family reunion, seeing Ron, and I've actually got family here, which I'm glad that that they have the time and opportunity. So you're in Washington, D.C. Not much going on in the news, right? Pretty boring. Great time to be in Washington, D.C. Great time to see what's going on in our country. And what I'd like to do today is really talk about three things. But as I'm talking about things, perhaps sometimes at a 50,000-foot level, realize that so much what I'm talking about is infused with what you are doing on your campuses. Because what you're seeing in Washington, D.C. is not just a sort of political struggle that's taking place among titans. What you're seeing is a battle of ideas, a battle that has gone on for decades and that will continue. And you all are going to play a crucial role in that. So what I'd like to do today is, first of all, talk a little bit about what actually happened in November. A lot of debate and discussion about that. What actually happened in November? Second of all, I'd like to look and try to answer the question, what actually and who actually is Donald Trump? What does he represent? A lot of debate about this. Is he a conservative? Is he not a conservative? How is he, I would argue, transforming American politics today? I would say in some ways that are very, very positive. And finally, I'd like to sort of look at the question, where do we go from here? Can we all kind of go home and watch college sports and relax and go to the beach? Or are there many battles to fight? And I'm going to argue that there are many battles to fight. So if you watch television, and I'm sure a lot of you do, and you follow the news, you kind of have sort of this template of their explanation of what happened in November. One form of it is that you basically had a lot of really angry middle-aged white men who finally showed up to vote, and they sort of put Donald Trump over the top. That's one of the explanations that the media offers. Second one is that Donald Trump appealed to sort of the worst instincts in America, and that all these bigots turned out to vote for Donald Trump. because he was promising to build a wall and carry out all these other policies. That's sort of the conventional wisdom. I'm going to argue that that conventional wisdom is really not correct, that the facts support an alternative explanation, and that what happened is actually extremely positive, not just for the Republican Party, but for the country in general. So what do I think actually happened? What I think you actually saw happen, unfolding through the Republican primaries and through the general election, is the American public essentially showing the middle finger to Washington, D.C. What do I mean by that? Well, think about how the Trump campaign unfolded. The Trump campaign unfolded with a series of scolding attacks on the political class in Washington, D.C., some of them intemperate, some of them, I think, quite pointed and accurate. And every time that these attacks unfolded, sometimes they were highly personal, sometimes they were directed at Washington in general, a lot of people in Washington, D.C. threw up their hands and said, it's done, it's over, his campaign is lost. And his campaign wasn't lost. His poll numbers actually seemed to go up. So what you saw in the early ruminations of the campaign was a candidate who very focused his attacks on the political establishment in Washington, D.C. That could be Republicans, that could be Democrats, that could be the bureaucracy, that could sometimes even be the American military. And the expectation of the conventional wisdom was, you do this, you're going to end up in trouble, and people are going to see you as, quote unquote, unpresidential. That's what you saw happening on the Republican side. What you saw happening on the Democratic side was something similar, albeit Bernie Sanders' attack was from the left, not from the right. What was Bernie Sanders' position? It was that the political class in Washington, D.C. was not responsive enough to the needs of the American people. They essentially weren't giving them enough free programs and enough free money. But the critique and the indictment was the same. Washington, D.C. is not responsive to what we, the American people, need and want. And I would contend that were it not for the superdelegate system in the Democratic Party, Bernie Sanders perhaps would have been the Democratic nominee. In other words, popular sentiment, even in the Democratic Party, was very anti-establishment. Now the general election comes along, Donald Trump wins. What do the exit polls tell us? The exit polls tell us that when you asked people who voted for Trump what was the number one issue that led you to vote for Donald Trump, 11% of the American people said build the wall. 11% of his voters, that was the number one issue. Corruption and draining the swamp and changing things in Washington, D.C., often polled in the mid to high 30s as the number one reason people chose to vote for Donald Trump. So my contention and my belief is that, yes, the policy positions that Donald Trump took as it relates to immigration, as it took to trade, certainly helped him with some voters in some states. But it was not the primary reason that people voted for him. They voted for him because they wanted to drain the swamp. And how bad is the swamp? Well, it's pretty bad if you ask the American people. Those same exit polls, when people were asked, is your representative or congressman honest or corrupt? Get a load of this. 75% of them thought that their own representative was probably corrupt. 3 out of 4. That, to me, is about as close as you get to a sagebrush rebellion in American politics. And generally, when surveys have been done over the last couple of years and people have been asked, is Washington, D.C., is there widespread corruption in Washington, D.C.? Again, 75 to 78% of the people say yes, that it is. So that is sort of the atmosphere in which Donald Trump won. And my contention is that this was an emotive but smart and calculated decision upon those people who were so frustrated with politics as usual in Washington, D.C., that they decided that they wanted radical change. So, where does this put us in the context of Donald Trump and his policies and his representations? Well, again, it depends who you talk to. If you watch most of the cable news on CNN or on MSNBC or on network television or NPR, you are going to get the impression that Donald Trump is an absolute nut job and that this guy should not have his hand on the nuclear finger and that he has no idea what he's talking about. On the other hand, if you talk to his supporters, they are going to tell you he's doing exactly what he says he's going to do and he's doing it with vigor. Well, where actually is the truth? Well, sometimes when you're trying to understand what's going on in our country, the best person to observe it for you is somebody from overseas. Of course, everybody's familiar with de Tocqueville and his assessment of the United States in the 19th century. Well, probably the best description that I've heard in looking at Donald Trump and the difference between his supporters and his critics comes from a writer who wrote a column recently for The Spectator, which is a great magazine out of the UK. And what this columnist said is this: Trump supporters take him seriously, but they don't take him literally. Trump supporters take him seriously, but they don't take him literally. Trump's critics take him literally, but they don't take him seriously. And that, to me, I think rings absolutely true. Now, what does that actually mean? What it means is this: Trump supporters look at what he says, his assessments of what some of the problems are in the country, and they have concluded that, yes, he is a serious man, he recognizes what the problems are, he's been a successful businessman, so he knows what he's doing, and we take his vision and his views very seriously. When he goes on Twitter, or when he does an interview and he makes statements that outrages people, we all know that he's basically trolling people or having fun, or there's a larger strategic purpose behind what he's doing. That's what Trump's viewers and supporters believe. His critics are making the mistake of doing the opposite. They don't consider Trump a serious person at all, which I think is a big mistake. But they dissect every single tweet and try to look for some deep, profound policy inference in every single thing that he says. And that's wrong, because you are then fundamentally misunderstanding how Donald Trump operates. So the question about Donald Trump is there actually a method to his madness? Or does this guy wake up in the morning and figure out that he wants to draw a lot of attention and make a lot of noise, but there's no substance there? I think there is actually substance there, and I want to obviously get some responses from you in the Q&A. I think there is substance there, and the substance essentially is this. Presidents in the United States oftentimes assume different roles. We have presidents who you could say function in a way as sort of the philosopher in chief. They have a strong policy vision, they are very engaged in their policy views, and they seek to sort of transform the views and the visions and the worldview of the American people. And two examples of that, I would say, would be Ronald Reagan, who had a profoundly philosophical view of the world. If you look at his writings, there's no disputing that. And who wanted to fundamentally change the views and the manners that people had about the free market, about individualism and liberty, and a whole host of issues. Ronald Reagan is an example of this kind of philosopher in chief. Another example on the left, of course, would be Barack Obama, who has a very different vision than Ronald Reagan, but Barack Obama believed that words could transform. And he believed that his words, perhaps in the tradition of Martin Luther King Jr. or William Jennings Bryan or others, he believed that he could have a profound effect with his words. That's not Donald Trump. Donald Trump does not believe that words fundamentally change things. And if you look at his history, you can completely understand why. This is a guy who's very practical, who's very specifically related to the business world, and built a business empire by getting things done. Now, what does that practically mean in terms of how Donald Trump operates? What it means is that Donald Trump believes that words are primarily a vehicle for getting something done. Anybody here read his book, The Art of the Deal? You should read it if you haven't, if you have the time. And the reason is because it's old, but it offers, I think, a lot of insight into the way that Trump views the world. And so let's take his view of words and his view of deal making. His view of deal making is very, very simple. If the president of this organization, Ron Robinson, has a $100 million piece of real estate — he doesn't, but I'm just giving you this grounds for illustration. If Ron Robinson has a $100 million piece of real estate that I, Donald Trump, want to buy, what am I going to do? I'm going to go visit his property, and I would say, Ron, this is a great building, but oh man, the neighbors look like hell. I think there's drug deals going on here. You know, this is an earthquake zone. I know it's New York City, but this is an earthquake zone. There's all kinds of terrible things that can happen. I think it's shoddy construction. I don't know who did. Donald Trump's view is you go into that negotiation with a strong effort to drive down the price. And what I'm going to do to that $100 million property that Ron Robinson has, that I'm willing to pay $90 million for, I'm going to say, Ron, I hate to insult you, but I'll give you $25 million for that property. Now, most people in that situation are going to get outraged. They're going to get insulted. They're going to say, this is unbelievable. This guy is sort of out of control. But you know what? I'm probably going to get that property for $80 million. I'm probably going to get, Ron's a shrewd negotiator, but if I'm Donald Trump in this scenario, I'm going to try to drive the price down. Am I going to hurt feelings by doing so? Absolutely. Am I going to come across as a cheapskate and maybe even a kook? Absolutely. But there's method to the madness. The point is, I'm staking out a maximalist position that's outrageous because my real goal is to get a position that's more realistic. And that is Donald Trump negotiating 101. So put that in the current context. We have debates going on right now. Donald Trump's been tweeting out about torture. I think torture works, and I think we should bring torture back. You've got his Secretary of Defense nominee, now Secretary of Defense, saying torture doesn't work. Everybody in the media is obsessing on the fact that Donald Trump is going to bring torture back. That's really what his goal is. Or that Donald Trump is going to deport, you know, 13, 14 million people who are immigrants into the United States. I would contend to you that's not his ultimate goal. His ultimate goal is to get more aggressive intelligence collection techniques that fall short of what people would define as torture. And his goal is to get a rigorous, intense legal enforcement of our immigration laws. Now, are you going to get that by issuing a white paper that says we need to do these policies, or are you going to get it by seeking out this sort of maximalist position? And my contention is that Trump's madness is really a method designed to extract this maximalist position. So for someone like Barack Obama, for whom words really matter, everything is about the speech, everything is about tone. He is less concerned about the actual results because he views himself as sort of a philosopher in chief. For Donald Trump, who's a deal maker, words are just there to try to get you to the final destination. They're there to try to get you to the final deal. So I think the mistake a lot of critics are making, a lot of people in the media are making, is they're focusing too much on taking him literally instead of taking him seriously. And this, by the way, is a particular and unique problem for who? For the national media. What is the currency of the national media? Words, right? I mean, that's everything. The national media is all about words. Who says something, what they say, what somebody says in response. It's all about words, and so much now in the era of Twitter and social media and 24-hour cable news is predicated and focused on what people are saying rather than a lot of time the things that are going on. So this is a particular disease that I think afflicts the national media and is really a problem in their culture. They don't understand a worldview that says words really are not that important when you're trying to negotiate and secure deals. So that is my assessment of Donald Trump, and I'd love to get, you know, people's thoughts on that here when we get to questions and answers, because I know it's an interesting question. Let me just ask people in the audience who were following or were involved in the Republican primary. In this audience, for how many people was Donald Trump your first choice out of all 15 people running? All right, we got some hands up. For how many of you was he the second choice? Okay, third choice. Okay, how many in this audience who were registered to vote voted for Donald Trump? Okay, large number. So you see this interesting evolution that's taken place. So we have Donald Trump now as president, and we have what I would argue is an earthquake occurring in Washington, D.C. And that earthquake, I think, is profoundly important, and by the way, I think is profoundly healthy. A lot of people in Washington right now are kind of having a heart attack about all of this. They think the Republic is over. This is a good and healthy thing. And think about this. We recognize the importance of sort of creative destruction, of sort of radical change in all parts of our lives. In the realm of technology, we think it's great, right? We like it when old technologies are essentially made obsolete and new ones develop. We like it in the business world when new companies emerge. We like it in military affairs when there's new sort of profound thinking that takes place in how military battles ought to be fought. For some reason, though, in Washington, D.C., there's this notion that we need to keep practicing politics the way that we always have. Well, that's not going to be the case anymore, and I think it's profoundly healthy. And that brings me to my third area, which is where are we going in the future, and what does it mean for us as conservatives? Now, I'm asked all the times, is Donald Trump a conservative? And I would say, I don't know, I can't look into the man's soul and determine the things. I would say that instinctually, Donald Trump is conservative. Intellectually, I think it's a little bit more complicated. Instinctually, his instincts are, I think, by and large, to be skeptical of governments, to be concerned about foreign adversaries. So he has those instincts. But when you look at his background and compare it to, say, Ronald Reagan, who had a long history of reading conservative books, taking conservative ideas seriously, you simply don't see that in Donald Trump. So what does that mean in terms of the future for how he might govern, and what does it mean for the conservative movement in general? Well, first of all, for the conservative movement, I think that Donald Trump is going to content with being an effective president. His goal is to be a successful, terrific, in his words, president. I don't think that Donald Trump is particularly concerned about being the leader of the modern conservative movement. And so what I think that means is his view is going to be kind of Maoist, let a thousand, you know, blossoms bloom. I mean, in other words, he is not going to have a problem with the conservative movement or people in the conservative movement criticizing him, because his goal is not to philosophically realign the country. His goal is to transform the way in which politics are done. So I think you are going to see a conservative movement that is engaged, that is committed to its principles and ideas, even when they are opposed to things that Donald Trump is doing. And I think that is a healthy and good thing. I think the second thing that you're going to see in the conservative movement is kind of a divide that occurs oftentimes with presidents, whether they're Republicans or Democrats, conservatives or liberals. You're going to have some that, for their own institutional interests, are going to cozy up to the powers that be because they want access. Maybe they want their friends or their family or people that work for them to get jobs in the administration. And you're going to see other organizations and groups that are more focused on principle and trying to be consistent. So I think the future for the conservative movement is very healthy. And this notion that people have that the conservative movement is over, that conservatism in American politics is over, I just don't think is accurate. And by the way, that prediction is being made by people who totally got the 2016 election wrong. Their predictions then were wrong, and I think they're wrong about this. And to be honest with you, I think there's just a lot of sour grapes among some people in the conservative movement who don't like Trump, didn't like Trump, said that it was going to end in disaster, and when it didn't, they ended up looking bad, and nobody likes to look bad. So I think the future for the conservative movement is good and very, very healthy, and you're going to play a big part in that as I talk here at the end of the speech. So what does it mean for governing in the country? I think it means a lot of very healthy things. We have had for too long among conservatives and liberals what I call the dictatorship of the experts. The dictatorship of the experts. What do I mean by that? Don't get me wrong. I think experts are great. I think it's important, if you're going to have a surgical procedure done, to have it be done by an expert, somebody who's actually studied and is a successful surgeon. If you're going to have plumbing done at your house, you want an expert. But Washington politics is different, and it was designed to be different by our founding fathers. In Washington, D.C., we have become too accustomed to the notion that the average American is ignorant, is stupid, who doesn't know how things should work, and that we just need to let the smart set run things, and we're going to be fine. That's basically, with a few hiccups, been the movement really since the 1960s in the United States. Well, guess what? Since the 1960s, things have not gone great. Things have not gone well. So what Trump represents is a rebellion against this notion of the expertise. The notion that if you get the smart people in the room, it's just a question of getting them in there, giving them the right resources, and they are going to fix all those problems. That kind of naive view for the American people is over, and it means that a lot of serious work can begin now on reforming institutions and dealing with problems like education, not through a centralized command in Washington, D.C., but by letting it be handled locally, because you've got individuals locally who are much closer to those issues. So the dictatorship of the expertise, I think, is over. I think the second thing that you're going to see happen is the change in the sort of industrial economy of Washington, D.C. Now, what do I mean by that? Industrial economy. There's no industry in Washington, D.C. Well, actually, there is. It's the influence industry. It's the government industry. It's the bureaucratic industry. And it's enormously prosperous. Think about this for a second. 2012, something very unusual happened, and a lot of people didn't notice. 2012, our seat of government power, Washington, D.C., passed Silicon Valley, California, to attain the post of highest per capita income in the United States. Think about that. A town that is about supposed to be about government and quote-unquote public service has a higher per capita income now than any other city in the country, even surpassing Silicon Valley. If you look geographically in the area around Washington, D.C., a study done a couple years ago found that of the 10 wealthiest counties in the United States, seven of the 10 are counties that border our nation's capital. So there's a big industry in Washington, D.C. It's based on government spending, it's based on influence, and it's based on government corruption and power. How Donald Trump is going to deal with that is another question, but this, at least so far, represents a hiccup in the industrial model. Because how did we get to this state? How did we get to the position where we have this massive wealth accumulating in our nation's capital? It's really very simple. It all comes down to how the game has been played and how our leaders have been selected. If you tell any candidate, any individual who wants to run for president of the United States, the model traditionally has been you need to go out and raise money, 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 money. You need to get people in, on Wall Street, you need to get people in the oil business, you need to get them to act as bundlers to raise money from them, and the person who raises the most money from the most people is going to win. And based on that logic in 2015, we should have seen Hillary Clinton against Jeb Bush, but that didn't happen. Then when it was Donald Trump against Hillary Clinton, we should have seen Hillary Clinton win in a landslide. She spent at least four times what Donald Trump spent on his election. Well, that didn't happen either. So what you saw in this election was a realigning of the industrial economy of Washington, D.C. So as Donald Trump has come in, he doesn't have the same sense of being beholden to lobbyists, to certain industries or certain sectors of the economy than other candidates or other predecessors would have been. Now, will he eventually fall into their fold? Who knows? He might. But he has a unique opportunity now to disrupt the political economy and the industrial economy of Washington, D.C. in a way that has not really been done since the 1980s when Ronald Reagan rolled into town. So on that account, we can expect a lot of changes. So let me just finally talk for a few minutes. How does this affect you on campus and the work that you're doing on campus? Well, I think it affects in a number of ways. First of all, you're going to have a fascinating next 4 years. Because I tell you, anytime Donald Trump says something or tweets something, you can see, combustion taking place on campuses. People needing to have their little secure zones or their safe spaces or clutching their little teddy bears because of every utterance that this man, in some cases 3,000 miles away, happens to be saying. So in that sense, there's going to be a lot of fun because it is not going to change. I don't think the Twitter's going away. But I also think it presents an opportunity for you to really open up and have discussions with people about what it is to be a conservative. And I think this is a very, very important point. If you look at the political left over the last 60, 70 years, their whole sense of identity and purpose is tied up with individual messiahs. First it was FDR. FDR was the messiah who was going to fix everything. Then it was John Kennedy and Camelot, this sort of, you know, personification of the individual. And of course, the penultimate example would be Barack Obama. If you remember in the 2008 election, he comes out on the stage in front of the adoring crowds, and you've got sort of the Greek Parthenon behind him, you know, where he speaks as this sort of philosopher king and gives these speeches about how he's going to lower the sea levels. I mean, it was absurd. It was absurd. But this is what the left does. On campus, how do they define themselves? They have pictures, they have t-shirts of Che Guevara, Fidel Castro. It's all individualized in this person, and ultimately, I would argue, is this sort of worship of these powerful figures. That's not conservatism. I love Ronald Reagan. Ron Robinson loves Ronald Reagan, but our view is always guided by principle, not by the person. And that is a huge distinction. So, you know, if Ronald Reagan were to, you know, come out tomorrow, you know, he's still alive and he's president, and he comes out tomorrow and says, I'm going to lower the sea levels and I am going to improve everybody's life by bringing you all joy, most conservatives would say, what's going on here? Because that wouldn't be consistent with conservative philosophy. So what does this mean in the era of Trump? It means it's an opportunity for you to say, why are you so obsessed with every single thing that political leaders say? Why is it that Barack Obama first and now Donald Trump define your life and define who you are? You're not a slave to anybody. We're guided by principles, we're guided by beliefs, we're guided by philosophies. And talk about those principles and beliefs. Conservatism is predicated on the idea that our political leaders are human beings, radical idea, and they are going to be tempted by hubris, by arrogance, by corruption. That's why we believe in limited government. So in the Trump era, you have an opportunity to segue the conversation to discuss about first principles rather than, you know, what somebody says in 140 characters or what somebody happens to say in an interview. It's really affords an opportunity to go deep into conversation with people, to talk about issues and talk about why you are a conservative and why you are skeptical about the size and scope of government. I've talked for way too long. I want to thank you, and I'd love to take any questions or comments that people might have. Thank you. So we can line up. There's a gentleman in the back with his hand up. Well, why don't we start there, and then we'll go here.
Just ask them to give their name and the school.
Yeah, the name and I love the bow tie, by the way. That's great. Right.
And that we're not going to be able to get enough conservatives into the school to be able to take them over a period of time. But one of the things, it's always a lot easier to destroy than to build something up. You've already given me the answer to my question. What do you think of that philosophy? How successful has it been? And primarily on polling, why do you think the polling was so off since 2010 and before that?
A great question. Thank you for your comments. A great question. Why was the polling so off? And to reiterate sort of what you were saying about institutions, what a lot of these institutions represent, whether it is a sort of the cult of reason on college campuses that you can analyze and intellectually solve everything if you just get smart people, they all represent in a way false gods. You know, C.S. Lewis talked about this. Everybody worships something. Everybody worships something. Nobody doesn't worship anything. So everybody worships something. And I think what people have to learn is, if you're going to end up worshiping at the altar of reason, or you're going to worship at the altar of polls, you're going to be disappointed because they make huge mistakes. And why were those polls so off? I think there are a couple of answers. Number one, I think most of the American people are pretty smart. And if somebody calls up and says, you know, I'm doing a poll for CBS News or I'm doing a poll for NBC News, who do you support for president? most Americans are going to calculate, it's a news outlet, I don't think they like the candidate that I like, so I'm just not going to tell them who I support. I think part of it was a sort of self-selection. People just weren't honest with pollsters. And this is a problem, particularly when you have a candidate like Trump where the coverage was so overwhelmingly negative, fair or unfair. When the pollster calls and says, I'm, you know, conducting this survey and I want to know, I think that's part of what the problem was. I think the second part of the problem is that just sort of, you know, people change in the way that they deal with pollsters and that they deal with telephone calls. If there's somebody calling my cell phone and I don't recognize the number, I never pick it up. And if they leave a voicemail, I might listen to it, but if they're a pollster, I'm certainly not going to call them back. So I think the notion of just being able to call people, I know they try to do it a little bit online, technology has not caught up with where people are. And I think people are more and more private. They're more reluctant to voice their views, particularly as conservatives, because you think of all the negative repercussions there's been for people. Whether, you know, you have the head of the tech company in California who had given to the marriage initiative, who had came out later, was basically drummed out of his job because of it. So I think we're going to see more of that, and it's emblematic to me of the sort of nature of where the left is today, which there are several people on the left that I would say have a sort of totalitarian impulse. They're incapable of dealing with dissent or dealing with disagreement. And by the way, in my view, that's not a sign of their strength, it's a sign of their weakness. Because if they were confident that your ideas had no attraction, they'd say, come on up, talk all you want, please, go ahead, keep talking. Because there was some, you know, their belief in that case would be, you know, everybody's going to hear what you have to say and not want to have any part of it. They know how attractive conservative ideas are. That's why they need to shut you up. It's a sign of weakness, not a sign of strength. Yes?
So in regards to...
I'm sorry, name and where you're from,
okay,
please.
Yeah, I'm Adam. I'm from the College of William & Mary, just south of here. And in regards to the idea that you should take Donald Trump seriously but not literally... and vice versa. I can definitely see where you should do that in certain instances, like the example that you gave. Mm-hmm. But in others, such as NATO is obsolete, I don't see how you can really take that not literally. It's like, is he being sarcastic?
Right.
So how do you interpret that?
Great question. Asking me about the question of taking Trump seriously but not literally. And the example he gave, which is a very good one, is where Trump said that NATO was obsolete. I think it was in a tweet or an interview. I can't remember which one it was. I guess it doesn't really matter.
I think it was a couple times.
Yeah, a couple of times. So let's think about this for a second. Do we think and believe that Donald Trump believes that NATO is completely obsolete and that we should just withdraw from NATO? It's possible, but we don't know. So that's one possible explanation. The other possible explanation is he believes, as other people do, that the United States carries an overwhelming amount of the weight in terms of cost, manpower, and resources in managing conflicts in the world, and he wants to renegotiate the deal. Donald Trump, the real estate guy, has had this lease that he's been paying. He thinks he's overpaying. He now wants to renegotiate the lease. So what's he going to do? Well, Donald Trump in real estate is going to say, you know what? I don't need that building anymore. So I might just walk away from this building and you can sue me if you want and, you know, we'll work it all out. But, you know, I don't think I really need that building anymore. His hope is that the landlord's going to come back and say what? Oh, well, you know, look, maybe we could work a little bit on the price. I think that it's probably a negotiating ploy. What confuses people is we've never had a president like this in this way. Reagan did some of this, but not nearly as much. So I think part of what is going on is we're in new territory. Now, some people would say, look, this is a dangerous way to handle things. You should not be telling the world that we don't think NATO is important. It's going to have these negative consequences. It's very, very possible that Donald Trump is saying this publicly and his national security aides are telling the Europeans different things privately. So that would be the question. But great, great question. Yes.
Michael Cornaccio at the University at Buffalo. You're talking about draining the swamp, and one of the interesting things for me from the election was Trump was campaigning against the establishment, and one of those names that comes to mind is Mitch McConnell. and now they're buddies. You know, I don't disagree with that. I think it's good that they're working together. But, you know, as far as draining the swamp and the 5-year lobbying delay, you know, how do you think that's all going to pan out?
Great question. I mean, Trump campaigned on drain the swamp, and the question really is, you know, how is the draining going? Well, you know, I think if you look at the swamp right now, maybe it's like the water level's dropped maybe a quarter of an inch, you know, a little bit. We'll give it a quarter of an inch, but it hasn't drained a whole lot. So the question is kind of where does it go from here? And to be realistic, what can actually be done? When you talk about draining the swamp, there's a couple of things a president can do by himself. A lot of it has to go through Congress. So term limits, for example, which I think is an excellent idea. I don't know anybody here likes term limits. Some conservatives are divided on that issue. I've come to actually like it. I was opposed to it before, but I'm now in favor of it. Term limits. To enact term limits, I think it's safe to say you need the support of Congress, and a lot of people argue you even actually need to amend the Constitution. So the question becomes something like that. You've got to get Congress to go along with you. And that is not necessarily an easy thing to do. And so the question was, he's now buddies with Mitch McConnell. You know, I think sometimes in life it's about picking battles. You've got to decide what are the priorities for you. You can't do everything all at the same time. Hopefully you're going to end up doing everything. You're just going to have to do it in a certain order. My sense of it is, and I don't base this on any sort of inside special knowledge, my sense of it is that the immediate priorities are to cut the corporate tax rate, cut American individuals' tax rates, and allow for the repatriation of funds overseas to get the economy going again. That, to me, seems to be the top priority for the Trump White House. So the question becomes, in the midst of that, is that the time to start pushing for term limits or some of these other things that you're going to have Congress support? And I would say probably the answer is not. I do believe that Trump has a unique opportunity if he chooses to take it, and I don't know if he'll choose to take it. The unique opportunity is this. Unlike any other American politician in the last 25 years, he is not beholden to a large class of donors from powerful industries. I mean, he didn't get a lot of Wall Street money. He didn't get a lot of money from lobbyists. They're not part of his political campaign coalition, which means he has a lot more freedom to be transformative in these areas than other candidates do. And I hope, for the sake of the country, that he gets to these reform agenda items once he pushes through his economic agenda, because that is a chance to be transformative. And just like the Democrats have sort of positioned themselves, I would say inaccurately, as the party of civil rights, based on the 1964 Civil Rights Act, which, by the way, was passed by Republicans, not Democrats. But they have defined themselves as the party of civil rights, primarily because LBJ was president when that took place. Trump has the opportunity to redefine the Republican Party as the party of political reform, the party opposed to cronyism, the party opposed to corruption, the party opposed to politicians self-enriching themselves. And if he does that, that really realigns politics in a major way. Whether he takes that opportunity, I'm not sure. I don't know.
Yes, my name is Scott Zipperly from the University of Alabama.
And then we'll go there. Yeah, sorry, go ahead. You go ahead. And then we'll go there. Yeah.
So do you think that Donald Trump will have the same influence in shaping the young culture the way that Barack Obama did? And do you think the radicalization of the left, following people like Sanders and Franken, will cause the Democratic Party to implode? Or do you think it'll snowball to the point where the nation will have to suffer to learn from their faulty ideology?
Great questions there about, is the Democratic Party going to implode, and will Donald Trump influence youth culture the way that Barack Obama did? Those are the two main questions, and I think they're great ones. I think, first of all, on the question of broader culture, I don't think that Trump views himself as a cultural figure. I think Barack Obama very much, and I think this reflected poorly on him as a president, viewed himself as a cultural figure. He spent so much time, you know, basically hanging out with cultural figures, you know, from Hollywood and from the music industry, and wanted to sort of define himself as cool, young, and hip. Now, I understand you do that part of it as you're trying to, you know, create this popular image, portray yourself in a certain way to garner votes. But I think with Obama, it was far deeper than that. It was in a sense the way in which he defined himself. And I think we don't want our national figures to define themselves as cultural figures. We want them to define themselves as leaders of our country and let the culture go its own route. I don't think Trump views himself in that same vein. I think that Trump likes attention. He likes the celebrity. He likes being provocative. He likes being on television. But I don't think he sits down and says, how can I get people to like me or connect with me? One of the things that's so interesting, I think, about the Trump phenomenon is that he did all the things wrong, according to the experts. You know, he didn't focus group before he sent out tweets. He didn't sit down and talk about how to parse his language. He just said what he felt. And even when he put his foot in his mouth, I think people liked the genuineness of it. So, you know, if you look at cultural trends right now, I mean, you've got sort of reality TV, which is not really that realistic, but it's reality TV. Why do people like it? It seems genuine. When you look at, you know, the phenomenon on YouTube, I mean, you've got people doing, you know, really simple kind of stupid things, shopping, and they've got millions of people following them on YouTube. Why? Because there's a certain genuineness to it that people connect with. Trump, I think, represents the same thing in politics. Like him or hate him, when you see Trump doing stuff, what you see is what you get. So I don't think the cultural thing, you know, has any appeal to him, and I just don't think he thinks that way. As far as the Democratic Party is concerned, I think they've got to, you know, really step back and sort of honestly assess what's going on. First, you know, their first basic position was taken by, you know, Bill Clinton 3 days after the election, that said, well, all Donald Trump proved was he can get angry white men to vote for him. So that was the first form of denial. Okay, you know, this just represents a bunch of racist bigots and yahoos in America that voted. The problem with that explanation is there are, you know, hundreds of counties in the United States that Barack Obama carried twice in 2008 and 2012 that in 2016 voted for Trump. So the question becomes, did all these people that are racist in 2016 vote for Trump, were they racist when they voted for Obama in 2012? No. So the math doesn't even add up to their explanation. So that was their first explanation, sort of racist bigots and everything like that. Second one is that the election was stolen. It was basically manipulated by the Russians, and that the average American is so stupid and moronic, they don't know that they were being manipulated by this foreign power. That's the second explanation. And now the third explanation seems to be that America's lost its mind because people don't want to impeach Trump yet. And all of those are various forms of denial. And what they need to do is step back and get serious. Stop, you know, paying attention to Twitter. Stop paying attention to what Trump is saying and look at what he is doing. He's one of the few presidents whose popularity rating has gone up now that he's taken office. With most presidents, they win in November, December, they've got good polling numbers, they start doing stuff, and their poll numbers go down because suddenly people feel kind of divided and they're kind of upset. Trump's is the opposite. In November, December, Trump's poll numbers were very poor. His poll numbers go up. He's now, I think, at 59% approval rating. Why is that? Well, he's doing stuff that people like. And I think the Democratic Party better start paying attention to that rather than, you know, holding protest rallies where people wear vagina hats and, you know, and all this other stuff, because, you know, the American people are smarter than a lot of people in Washington give them credit for. And if there is not a serious, coherent worldview that the Democrats come up with that appeal to voters, they will lose again.
Thank you.
Sure. Yes, in the back.
His condition
Yeah.
He ordered the 70 or 80 hamburgers a day and thought that, you know, the poor guy couldn't get out of bed, so he needed help. And the difference is that our government has hundreds and hundreds of enablers on Capitol Hill.
Yeah.
And so what they're saying is, this guy needs more diet pills. Don't change anything else. Just keep things going.
Right.
And I have to tell you, I feel more hopeful now than I have in so many years, because it gets to the point where when you call bad things good or good things bad, and you see that it progresses and builds and becomes an insanity, and you see your own countrymen standing up for this insanity, I was just ready to give up. But I feel hopeful at last.
Thank you. No, thank you. No, that's, I appreciate that. No, it's very, very interesting to watch kind of the dynamics in the country. And you know, if you want any further evidence of how divided the country is, you're seeing two things going on simultaneously. Roughly half of the population is now wildly optimistic, and the other half of the population is in absolute panic. And, you know, all that I'm saying to friends and people that I know that are, you know, politically liberal, and I've known them for years, is I just, you know, a year from now, because right now, if you go on Facebook, you go on social media, they are absolutely apocalyptic. I mean, it's not even like, oh, I'm kind of worried my taxes are going to go up, or I'm kind of worried this is going to happen. It's like, no, we're all going to die, and we're going to die soon. So, you know, I'm just keeping calm, and then at some point, I'm just going to say, hey, you know, everybody, please go back and look what you were saying a year ago. We're all still here. Buildings are still standing. Economy's still going. You know, Lord willing. We are a very divided country, and it is not division, by the way, in my mind, based on race or class. It's basically your view of the world. And if you believe that as individuals we are empowered and we have the capability and the capacity to govern ourselves, to rule our lives, to exercise self-discipline, as you were talking about, then you are optimistic right now, because there's somebody in the White House who is saying, I'm going to return power to you and give empowerment to individuals. That's what he's saying. If you are somebody who believes that, you know, by and large, most people are stupid, and they need somebody to tell them what to do, somebody to take care of their health care, somebody to take care of their education because they can't save their own money to do it, if you view the world that way, you are in an absolute panic, because this is kind of the equivalent of a father telling his, you know, 24-year-old son, hey, it's time to move out of the basement. It's time to get an apartment and kind of live on your own. And, you know, stop all this business. So that, I think, psychologically shows the division in the country. So, yes. One more question. Yeah. Let's do two quick ones if we can.
All right. My question is kind of about draining the swamp again. I know Trump's only been in office for a short time, but you look at his appointments, and I think that's a first big thing that a lot of people say is draining the swamp. This movement against the establishment, do you think that him replacing political establishment people with corporate establishment, you know, Tillerson, DeVos, and these very rigid large companies, do you think there'll be a tangible impact, or that it's more of kind of a facade and the bureaucracy still might be there because it was still an establishment and they still do come from an establishment that's just called something else?
Great question. Are these corporate cabinet appointments, do they represent draining the swamp or more of the same? And honestly, I think time will tell. I think a lot of the appointments that I have not liked, some of the people from Wall Street who are now running Treasury and others, do not represent a change from too big to fail and a lot of the crony capitalism that we've all grown accustomed to. So, you know, time will tell. Hopefully you've got some guys who rose the corporate ranks, who ran major corporations, who had rebel hearts all along. And now they've got a chance to be transformative. I think a guy like Tillerson may represent that, but time will tell. But that's a very fair and legitimate question, I think.
Awesome, thank you.
Sure, yes, final question.
All right, Andy Schnard, IUPUI. You talked about that this was a rebellion against the experts thinking they knew everything the people didn't. How do we keep our experts accountable? Because this is like the worst way to like save us from dumb experts. Like, how do we have this in a much more constructive way where our experts actually help us and we help them?
Great question. How do we hold experts accountable? This, I think, is a fundamentally important question, because you think about so many areas of life, jobs that people have. If you're an accountant, I mean, there's a very, very sort of objective way to evaluate if a person is a good accountant or not. You know, if you're a sports athlete, I mean, there are reams of statistics. The problem is you've got a lot of experts who are making hugely important decisions about healthcare, 20% of the American economy, who have horrific track records when it comes to these issues. You've got, professor from MIT who designed Obamacare, who basically said the American people are idiots and morons, and we need to lie to them. That is a view that is more widespread. So that question, which I don't really have a direct answer for, is fundamentally important. That is, how do we hold experts accountable for their past failures? And I think if we can figure out a way to do that realistically and effectively, we are going to have a much healthier country going forward. With that, I'm going to say thank you and turn it back over to Jessica.